embarrassing.
Dark Souls. It's a fun game, but it's also a game that's broken many hearts, minds, and controllers. Many people consider Dark Souls to be so hard and so challenging that it's ultimately unfair, and thus poorly designed. But contrary to what many people say, I personally consider Dark Souls to be one of the most well-designed games of the last generation. And yes, I do think it's fair. It's very easy to mess up a game's difficulty, and it's ultimately a balancing act. A lot of it comes down to who exactly you're marketing toward. A lot of hardcore gamers complain about the level of hand-holding and tutorials in a lot of modern games, but if you want to broaden your demographic, that's kind of an accommodation you have to make. But one of the many things that makes Dark Souls stand out is that it's effectively a refuge for masochists. Like me. In all seriousness, the Souls games are getting more and more popular, and I'm very happy about that, but the game's reputation still precedes it, and I feel like way too many people are being scared off by the difficult reputation of the game, so I thought now would be a good time to clear up some misconceptions about this series. A lot of people say this game and its sequels are brutally hard and unwelcoming, and thus filthy casuals need not apply. Well, all that really does is scare off people from playing what might be one of their own favorite games if they gave it a chance. The game does quite a bit to ease you into its challenging gameplay, and uses some ingenious design to point you in the right direction without spelling out the solution. And that's how Dark Souls instills such a great sense of accomplishment. It expects you to play smart and learn from your mistakes and find your own way forward. So today we're going to look at how I think Dark Souls gets you comfortable with its brutal brand of fun. And then in another video, I'll discuss the symbolism and subtext of the theming. Or something. I might make a bunch of videos like this, honestly. I don't fucking know. I'm trying to justify how much of my life I've spent playing Dark Souls, basically. I really like this game. Our happy-go-lucky journey starts in the Undead Asylum, and right off the bat the game introduces various mechanics in a pretty fast-paced way. And then this happens. Welcome to Dark Souls. Now this seems pretty damn unfair until you realize how little damage this boulder actually does. It's probably not going to kill you, and it's a very predictable trap once you go through it once, and again, it only happens once. This is what I like to call warning damage, because much like putting your hand on a stove as a child, this is the kind of mistake most people will probably make only once. I hope. This is a game that will occasionally throw traps at you, so it's good that it establishes that now. And in that trend, in a few moments, it has a pair of weak enemies waiting in ambush right around a corner. You pretty much have to stand there and just take it in order to be killed by these guys because they do such little damage, but again, they serve as a warning for the kinds of traps and ambushes that await you in the future. Even the boss of this area needs to hit you pretty much 3 times in a row in order to kill you, and you already have a reasonably spammable healing item. In addition, it has very predictable attacks with a big windup. It's pretty easy to read, even for a new player. And despite how monstrous a thing looks, it actually doesn't have a lot of hit points. You can wrap up the fight in about 30 seconds. So the game introduces some of its core mechanics, warns you about the kind of threats that await you without being too punishing to the point of being frustrating, pins you up against a big baddie, gives you a big old confidence boost, a nice pat on the ass, and sets you on your way. In just 5 to 6 minutes of gameplay. That's a pretty impressive way to kick off the game. Now, a big reason a lot of people love RPGs is the thrill of building your own interesting character. a character that can deal with all the different threats that the game throws at you that you built up and planned out yourself. That's really fun. But when you're picking your first character in a brand new RPG that you've never played before, it can be a little daunting. In a lot of games, the classes are very important and distinct from each other. So a lot of your decisions are effectively front-loaded before you've actually even played the game. And that's never made any sense to me. Why not have these decisions be flexible and dynamic? Have characters that you can customize fairly easily as you learn more about the game and journey through the world. Well, Dark Souls does just that. You see, the characters are different enough to be interesting, but there's no abilities exclusive to any class, and any character can use any armor, any weapon. It just might take a few more level ups and a bit more effort for you to get there depending on who you picked, and I think that that's a really good system, and I'd really like to see more stuff like that. But that's not even the sexy bit. The sexy bit is, as soon as you start playing the main game and get to Firelink Shrine, you can customize the hell out of your character right off the bat within a few minutes. But not with menus, not with dialogue choices that customize your character further, but organically by exploring the environment. It's really sexy. Let's talk about it. Transition. As soon as the player lands in Firelink Shrine, they have a lot of options, especially if they chose the Master Key at the beginning, which they should. You can immediately gather various souls and useful tools, with no fear of encountering enemies while exploring the shrine itself, which rewards exploration immediately right out of the gate. I also like how they include a bunch of souls just scattered around that the player can use to level up, so you can start customizing your character right away, which is a nice alternative to just encouraging people to grind for souls and repetitive gameplay. If you venture into the graveyard, you meet with several spooky, scary skeletons who are way too powerful for new players, or people who suck. But exploring just a bit and using your agility to avoid them will reward you with one of the best spears, one of the best swords, and a useful shield that can reduce magic damage that no one ever uses, as well as more souls, the game's currency. So just by exploring the shrine and graveyard, you'll find a low requirement strength weapon, two dex weapons, two magic teachers with a total of six spells, a shield, two magic catalysts, one of which is completely free, and enough souls to level up 3 to 4 times or purchase some starter magic. You can also find some free humanity and fire bombs, and other tools. I found all of this within the first 10 minutes of arriving at Firelink Shrine. And if you chose the Master Key, which again, you should, and figure out a safe way to dispose of this powerful but very stupid dragon, you can also get a great medium shield and a decent faith weapon for clerics and knights. Here's what's so great about this game design. An experienced player can just quickly grab whatever they need in a few minutes, and a newbie has to earn these rewards by thoroughly exploring the area, learning the game's mechanics, fighting some tough enemies in a smart way, or just learning how to evade enemies. All in low-stakes situations because all of these areas are so close to the Firelink Shrine where you respawn and you can just collect all your souls after you die. So veteran players can do what they need to do quickly, reducing the repetitive gameplay of a repeated playthrough, and newbies have to actually earn their rewards, but they don't risk too much to be frustrating. I find this to be one of the most underrated elements of the entire game. It caters to both noobs and pros equally. Another nice inclusion is a group of seemingly catatonic hollows located directly below Firelink Shrine. As far as I can tell, they're pretty much there exclusively so you can practice using new weapons and spells on them and learn your movesets. And no, I don't feel bad about that. Doesn't seem like they got much going on here, to be honest. Once you start heading toward the Undead Burg, the intended route, the game starts to show its excellent sense of pacing. It starts out with the enemies spread out so you can fight them one-on-one, but it gradually starts to pack enemies more tightly together and throws in some ranged attackers as well. All these enemies still do fairly little damage, but this gradual increase of difficulty is very nicely done. The game rewards patience, caution, and strategy, and it looks like it's going to be a nice, gentle difficulty curve from here on. Oh! Here he is, the first major roadblock for new players, the Taurus Demon. The first time I met this bastard, I thought it was completely hopeless. I was in a very narrow path, he had an incredible range, speed, and power, and unlike previous enemies, he could actually kill me in two hits pretty easily. After dying a few times, I eventually realized something. I remembered that I could do a plunging attack, like from the tutorial. So I could climb a ladder and do a plunging attack to deal a lot of damage to this guy all at once. And this is usually enough to take him out in just three hits in and of itself. And now, looking back at how I fought him back then, it's actually kind of funny. Now that I'm more experienced, I can just take him out with a few normal attacks and some well-timed dodge rolls. The fact that this boss is so overwhelmingly difficult at first, but is now just a cakewalk, is a testament to this game's design. Because I don't know if you've noticed, I'm not very good at this game. But through practice and observation, I was able to find my own solution to the challenge. No one told me that this thing was weak to attacks from above. I just kind of looked at the game mechanics and figured it out on my own. And even though in retrospect it's kind of an obvious solution, the fact that they let the gamer come to their own conclusion like that, it's more satisfying. Letting players figure out their own solution without being patronizing gives them this warm, fuzzy feeling in their little gaming hearts. When I first started playing Dark Souls, of course I was intimidated. I quickly learned that this game wasn't exactly going to be pulling its punches, so one of the first things I considered was, how do I keep my character nice and adaptable to all these different situations? And that's why it's such a great idea that within the first 10 minutes, you have access to so many different kinds of weapons, a few spells, plenty of souls for leveling up and customizing your character, purchasing new stuff, and some long-ranged weapons, and a nice big safe space to test it all out on really weak enemies. All of that stuff is done intentionally, and I never hear anyone point out that stuff, which is why I find it so sad that people dismiss this game as being unfair. Contrary to what Souls veterans might say, Dark Souls is a hard game, yes, but people don't play it and love it just because it's hard. They play it because it's rewarding. It's a game that respects your intelligence and expects you to play smart, to learn from mistakes. Without this level of difficulty, the game wouldn't give players such a profound sense of accomplishment. Dark Souls isn't for everyone, but if you're even just a bit more interested in it after watching this video, I need you to do two things. One, like and subscribe because it will validate my existence, and second, give Dark Souls a try. You'll be hard-pressed to find a more rewarding gaming experience, and I think it's something everyone should at least give a shot. I was serious about the subscribing and liking thing. I have a child to feed. You don't want this on your conscience. Look at her little ears. Don't be that guy. Hi, I hope you liked the video. You're still here, so I'm assuming that you did. And if you did, you should smack the subscribe button and share the video around to make me feel better about myself. You can also get constant updates and bad jokes on my Twitter and Facebook in the description, and you can check out my recent videos by clicking the annotations on screen. Also, I have a bit of a special announcement for anyone who's interested in supporting the show on Patreon. Now, this show is very close to achieving full-time job status, but it's exclusively supported via patron donations. And I am incredibly grateful that I can actually say that, so thank you all so much. No matter how you support the show, I'm very grateful. So as a thank you, and a little incentive, I'm going to launch a new reward for all donators who pledge at least $1 per video. It's not a big thing, but I plan on letting donators view little bonus videos about a week early, before everyone else gets to see them. These videos will still go public pretty quickly, but basically, you'll get to see them first if you donate. That's it. These videos will include little things like gameplay commentary, skits, and short little editorials and stuff. And I won't charge patrons for anything besides my main reviews and symbolism vids. Just saying, I feel the need to emphasize this. These are just fun little bonuses that donators happen to get to see early, but everyone will get to see them. You also get to comment and leave questions on these videos, and we can have a nice little hangout. The main reviews and symbolism videos will remain completely unchanged, and the top tier patrons will get exclusive access to the full episode previews just like always, and everyone will be able to see every final video I make. I'm never going to make donation necessary to enjoy this show. I will never do that. But I do want to reward the people who help make the show possible, especially now that the show is so close to just being my full-time job. I'm really passionate about making this stuff, and I really wanted to thank the people who justify all the time I spend doing it. So, thank you. I think I found a nice middle ground for a reward here, but please feel free to give me some feedback on this idea. I am open to suggestions, as always. Sorry for the spiel. A lot of you probably didn't even listen to that. Bye-bye.